Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to another session of Learn from the Masters. For today's session, we'll be having Dr. Malik. Dr. Malik Arjun, who's our cornea and refractive consultant at Sankara Hospital, Shimoga. He has a vast experience in dealing with patients with keratoconus and managing them accordingly. He'll take us on a journey with essentials of keratoconus. Over to you, Dr. Malik.
Thank you, Dr. Saptagiresh. Good afternoon to all of you, and best wishes on this Good Friday. I'll be talking on essentials of keratoconus. Probably this would help postgraduate students and general ophthalmologists and those who are not into only cornea practice. I have no financial interest of the any product shown here or any instrument shown in this presentation. Now, what is keratoconus? Actually, it is derived from the Greek words. Kerato means cornea and conus means cone. That is keratoconus. It's a non-inflammatory progressive corneal thinning which leads to protrusion of the thinned cornea. At present, you have to consider it as a non-inflammatory, but still there are many studies are going on whether is it an inflammatory one, because till we get the substantial evidence and research, now we should consider it as a non-inflammatory. Usually it is bilateral, but asymmetric. Some patients with present it only in one eye, other eye being normal, and sometimes one patient present with advanced keratoconus in one eye and very subtle changes in other eye. There is no gender prediction. Both sexes are affected equally. And it is most common primary ectasia. Among all corneal primary ectasia, keratoconus is a most common. What it causes high myopia and irregular astigmatism, not because of axial, not axial myopia, because of the cone it produces, it increases axial length and causes high myopia and irregular astigmatism, thus affecting the visual quality. And most commonly seen in the second decade at puberty age. And it can also be seen in pediatric age group as well as after the age of 30 years. The good thing about keratoconus is it stabilizes by the fourth decade. That is what the current evidences show. Clinical presentation. Usually patients present with blurring of vision, distortion of vision, monocular diplopia, glare, halos, difficulty in night driving, frequent changes of glasses, and not happy with the contact lens they are wearing. And also sometimes they just present with the ocular irritation. In advanced cases, they present with sudden drop in vision, pain, and photophobia. That's a presentation of high drops. When to suspect keratoconus? This is very important for us in a day-to-day practice, because the diagnosis of the keratoconus depends on suspecting the patient and subjecting them to the investigation. If the patient comes with a history of eye rubbing, especially in children with history of VKC, allergic conjunctivitis, in your routine examination, if the auto K reading is more than 48, a patient with high irregular astigmatism, and sometimes the patient should come with a vision 6x6 on central vision chart, but they'll be complaining of, doctor, I don't have, now my vision is not good. I don't know. I don't know how to explain about it. But my vision was good previously, but now I can see, but it is not that good what I was seeing earlier. These patients, you have to suspect something in the cornea. I mean keratoconus. And recent onset of refractive error in late first decade and second decade, that you should be very suspicious in such cases, because the keratoconus would have set in, and that is causing some myopia, and they are not worn the glasses earlier in their myopic age group, but recently they have started wearing. So you should have a suspicious of something ectasia forming in the patients. Typically, some set of patients, they complain of, doctor, my vision improves on pressing on eyeball. That happens because whatever the irregularity or astigmatism will somewhat correct when you press on the eyeball. And these patients are not happy with their glasses or contact lens. And I should undergo refractive surgery to get rid of my glasses, and so that I'll be all right. So whenever patients come for the refractive surgery, telling that my vision is not good, the contact lens or glasses, you should have a suspicion of keratoconus. And also, of course, if there is a family history of keratoconus, you should suspect keratoconus. Now, what are the signs we see in keratoconus? Fletcher's ring, it's an iron ring just at the base of the keratoconus cone. It is because of accumulation of iron deposits from the tear film onto the cornea, usually seen at the subepithelial level. It can be seen very clearly with cobalt blue filter. Such iron lines can be seen in other conditions also, like bleb, any elevated lesion at the conjunctiva, like pterygium, and any other ectasias in the cornea. Oak's ray is a vertical fine lines at the posterior stroma at the level of Desmoid membrane. These are usually vertical in line, and when you apply slight pressure, they tend to disappear. This happens because when there is a protrusion of the cornea, there is a stress lines. These are all the stress lines at the DM Desmoid level. Because it is a protruding forward, there has to be some, it is a causing stress at the posterior stroma that results into this strae. One more important sign is iron droplet sign. This is best as appreciated by distant direct ophthalmoscopy, or when you direct the pupil and do a retroillumination. See, this picture shows the classical sign of iron droplet reflex. You can see just an eye, something drop is falling here. And this sign can be seen in other conditions like anterior lenticonus, even in a posterior lenticonus can also be seen. What happens when this keratoconus becomes more apparent, like when it becomes a little bit advanced? There will be breakage in the Bowman's membrane. These breakages will be filled by fibrous tissue, so thus forms the apical scarring. This is an anterior segment OCT of the keratoconus with apical scarring. You can see the hyperreflectivity here, and also you can easily see in the treatment examination also. Another sign is prominent corneal nerves. And these lines you can see in the slit lamp, and these white faint lines can be seen in the stroma, and this has to be differentiated from other conditions, like most commonly is something the lattice dystrophy. Okay. The most important clinical examination I would say is to detect the keratoconus, I would say is good retinoscopy. If you have a good command on the retinoscopy, you can diagnose the keratoconus in very early stages by appreciating the Caesar's reflex. In advanced keratoconus, the cone becomes more advanced. And when you ask the patient to look down and you see from the top, there will be indentation of this cone indents on the lower lid, causing the V-shaped lid. That is called as Munson sign. One more sign is rigidity sign. This is a conical reflection on the nasal cornea when a pen light is shown from the temporal side. See, pen light is shown here. You can see a nice conical reflection at the nasal sign. This is also a sign of advanced keratoconus. Sometimes patients may present with acute hair drops. That is because of the breaks in the Desmond membrane. Because of the breaks in the break in the Desmond membrane, aqueous imbibes into the stroma and causing stromal edema, and patient will present with sudden loss of vision, photophobia, pain. Etiology. It has shown that it can be autosomal dominant mode of inheritance with variable expression. And also excessive degradation of the corneal stroma and proteolytic enzyme activity in the cornea. Oxidative damage has also been shown to be etiology of the keratoconus because of ultraviolet radiation, atopy, mechanical trauma due to chronic eye rubbing, and some set of the patients, those who are using contact lens wear, because that also acts like a micro trauma to the cornea. There are many ocular associations with the keratoconus, like eye rubbing, atopy, vernal keratoconjunctivitis, retinitis pigmentosa, Leber's congenital amaurosis, aniridia, corneal dystrophies, even Fuchs, granular dystrophy, posterior polymorphic corneal dystrophy, also has been shown to be associated with keratoconus. Many systemic conditions are associated with keratoconus, like Marfan syndrome, Down syndrome, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, osteogenesis imperfecta, and mitral valve problem. These are the major associations, but there are also many other systemic conditions that those are associated with keratoconus. Histopathology changes keratoconus. The main histopathologic and change in the keratoconus is Bowman's layer breakage and stromal corneal thinning and iron deposits within the corneal epithelial basis layer. But it has been shown that all the layers of the cornea can be affected by the keratoconus. There can be changes in the endothelium as well. This is the classification widely used for the staging of the keratoconus, that is Amsler-Schmidt classification. Stage one is excessive stiffening, myopia, induced astigmatism, or both less than 5 diopters. Mean central K reading less than 48 diopters. Stage two is myopia, induced astigmatism, or both 5 to 8 diopters. Mean central K reading less than 53 diopters. Absence of scarring, corneal thickness more than 400 microns. Grade stage three is myopia, induced astigmatism, or both 8 to 10 diopters. Mean central K reading more than 53 diopters. Absence of scarring, corneal thickness 300 to 400 microns. Grade stage is a very advanced stage. Here refraction is not measurable. Mean central K reading more than 55 diopters, central corneal scarring on corneal thickness less than 200 microns. There are different cone morphology have been described. Common are nipple or round. It will be of less than or equal to 5 millimeter diameter, located in the central or paracentral area, commonly in the infranasal quadrant. One more is oval, cone diameter will be more than 5 millimeter, paracentral or peripheral location, commonly in the infratemporal quadrant. when you suspect a patient by our clinical examination, and we have to subject them for investigations. The main investigation is corneal topography, but only placebo-based topography are absolute nowadays because it estimates only the entry surface of the cornea. So we need to study the entry surface, posterior surface as well, and corneal thickness as well. So you are studying it in a three dimension of the cornea. So now the name is corneal tomography. The common corneal tomography is used are Pentacam, Sirius, and Galileo. They are based on the Schimpflug-based imaging. Sirius has one advantage. It has both Schimpflug imaging as well as placidodisc-based analysis. Other investigation which would help us to diagnose keratoconus or anti-segment causality, it should be high definition and ocular response analyzer. In Pentacam, it analyzes the corneal thickness in multiple areas and also locates the thinnest, and it identifies the thinnest corneal thickness and also the location of the thinnest cornea. And also it analyzes the posterior corneal elevation, which is very important because the keratoconus starts first at the posterior surface of the cornea. So if there is elevation of 12 to 15 microns on anterior surface and 18 to 22 microns on the posterior surface, we should have a suspicion of abnormal cornea or keratoconus. This is the picture of Pentacam. It shows the inferior steeping here in a sagittal map. And there is in a elevation map, anterior elevation form, there is a elevated area, significant elevation. And in the posterior elevation, also there is an elevation. And the minimum thickness is 509. So this is a suspicion of keratoconus. And it also has one more a software called a Belin Embryos Enhanced HSCM map. What it does is, it whatever the small elevations or small irregularities are there on the cornea, it will enhance them by using the enhanced best fit sphere. So it combines the 9 different tomography parameters in unified screening tool, and also gives various indices which will help us to diagnose the early keratoconus or form first keratoconus or established keratoconus. This is the picture of Belin Embryos dysplasia. First two are pictures of front elevation and back elevation by the normal best fit sphere. These two are the pictures of the front elevation and back elevation made by enhanced best fit sphere. Here you can see that definitely there is a elevation here in the posterior cornea, and these two give the difference between these two. So this would help us to diagnose the keratoconus, and also it gives the percentage of the corneal thickness map, how it behaves from the center to the periphery. Usually it deviates from the center at 6. And if it's falls before 6, then there is a suspicion of keratoconus. And these indices are given in a white, yellow, and red indices. And white shows the white demarcates is a normal. Yellow shows the suspicious, and red is a established. So here the final indices shows 2.53. In this case is a early keratoconus or suspicious keratoconus. One more Schimpflug plus placidodisc combined tomography is Sirius. Now it is widely being used in day-to-day practice, and it shows it has a thickness map here, and here it shows the 501 thickness here. And this map, anterior tangential map, is estimated by the placidodisc. So here you can see the classical asymmetrical bow tie in with inferior steepening, and also show the anterior elevation and the posterior elevation. There is significant posterior elevation also here. So this is a case of early keratoconus. Like it also has a separate software where you can screen the keratoconus. It gives a final one vector graph like here after considering the all the indices and also the keratometry values and also the higher order aberrations. So you have to look for this red line. If the red line falls in this green zone, then it is normal. If the red line comes up to this yellow zone, then it can be a suspicion of ectasia. If it falls in yellow, again it is a suspicion of ectasia. And if it totally falls in this red zone, then there is an established keratoconus. One more tool is anti-segment OCT. It helps in detection of characteristic corneal stromal and epithelial thickness changes in eyes with subclinical keratoconus. Studies have shown that there will be focal thinning of the epithelium on the cone. So this would also help in diagnosing the early keratoconus. This is the picture showing the epithelial map and comparison of the pachymetry map, epithelial map and stromal map in a normal subclinical keratoconus and form first keratoconus. If you see in a normal case, this pachymetry map shows normal and epithelial map also, and these color coded are, these color codes are based on the thickness. So epithelium shows normal and stromal PD also shows a normal. But when you see in a subclinical keratoconus, there is a thinning over here in the pachymetry map, and there is definitely epithelial thinning over the epithelial map and also in the corresponding stroma. So epithelial mapping, epithelial thickness mapping in the keratoconus also help us to diagnose early keratoconus. One more investigation is ocular response analyzer. What it does is it estimates the corneal hysteresis and also corneal resistance factor. And these both two are altered in the keratoconus. In this machine, there will be air puff that will be thrown on the cornea, and how the cornea behaves to that air puff will be analyzed by these waveforms. This is the patient with the normal eye. Here the corneal hysteresis shows the 10.5, which is considered to be normal. And keratoconus, in the keratoconus, corneal hysteresis is almost 4. And this one has a limited diagnostic ability for the incipient keratoconus. And also it will be very helpful in a follow-up of the patients of the patient post C3R surgery. A small note on keratoconus in pediatric age group. In pediatric age group, it will be very aggressive. Aggressive in the sense it progresses very rapidly, and we should have a high suspicion of a keratoconus in a pediatric patients, especially when the patients in patients with VKH and patients those who have a high astigmatism, even if it is a regular astigmatism also, and unexplained decreased vision in a pediatric patients, we should have a high suspicion of keratoconus. And these patients, we have to subject them to corneal tomography and estimate, we should know whether the patient has keratoconus or not. And also we should also follow them regularly. Here, in a pediatric case, the diagnosis of the keratoconus at the early stage is very important because as I said earlier, it progresses very fast. And we should have a close follow-up of the patients. And if you have a small evidence of any progression of the keratoconus, you have to intervene earlier, because the pediatric patient, they'll have a so much long life, and we have to intervene then as early as possible. And what are the differential diagnosis of keratoconus? Mainly there are two differential diagnosis, that is pellucid marginal degeneration and Terence marginal degeneration. The age of onset in keratoconus is second decade, and in PMD it is second to fifth decade. Terence marginal usually starts in the elderly patients. It is all three present in bilaterally, and in keratoconus male and female are equally affected. Some PMD also male and female are equally affected. In Terence marginal degeneration, male affected more. Astigmatism in common in all three conditions. Thinning is paracentral in essentially in infrotemporal or infronasal in keratoconus, and thinning is inferior in pellucid marginal degeneration, especially at the 4 to 8 clock hours. This thinning is just above the thinning, there will be elevation of the cornea. That is the diagnostic criteria in pellucid marginal degeneration when you examine through slit lamp. And in Terence marginal, the thinning starts usually in the superior area. Vascularization are not seen in keratoconus and PMD, and there is a vascularization in Terence marginal degeneration, and it crosses the area of thinning. Lipid deposition seen only in the center in the Terence marginal degeneration. Hydrops and perforation and hydrops can be seen in keratoconus and pellucid marginal degeneration, and in Terence marginal degeneration it is unusual. The management depends on the severity of the keratoconus. In mild to moderate cases, we can use spectacles or contact lenses. And just by giving spectacles and contact lenses, the treatment is not over, because we are not dealing with the exact pathology of the keratoconus, because most of the time it will be progressive. So you need to monitor them periodically to assess the progression. You have to do a baseline tomography, and periodically you have to assess them to assess the progression. Other treatment modalities are corneal collagen cross-linking and PRK with extra intracorneal ring segments. These are the various contact lenses available for contact lens keratoconus. You can start with the soft toric lenses and the gas permeable lens like Roesky lenses, Icon, Soper lenses, Minisclear lenses. These are the companies which give Minisclear lenses, and scleral lenses and hybrid lenses. As far as I know, the most commonly used keratoconus lens in India is Roesky lenses. It has a posterior curve that closely fit the abnormal conical cornea. So the posterior curve is there is area where the cone can be fitted here, and as you know, the keratoconus has a multiple focal points. That's why the patient will get a distorted vision. Because of this unique design, the design of Roesky lenses, it makes one single point focal point at pupillary area, thus making the vision very clear. Scleral lenses are very useful in ectatic conditions of the cornea. Scleral, as name suggests, scleral lenses, they rest on the sclera. Rest on the sclera, that means that the conjunctiva about that sclera. And it has a vault over the cornea, and there are three zones of the scleral lenses. One is a corneal zone, and this is a transition zone and a scleral zone. Transition zone is between corneal zone and the scleral zone. And there will be a space between the cornea and the posterior surface of the scleral lens, which will be filled by the reservoir fluid. this reservoir fluid will make the cornea smoothen. Irregular cornea will become smoothen. Thus, the patient will see clearly, and the best corrected vision also would improve. And regular scleral lens come in a diameter of 20 to 24 millimeter. And mini scleral lens, because of the bigger diameter, it can touch the lid and it can cause mild discomfort. To overcome, now the mini scleral lenses have come. That measures usually between 14 to 17 mm. Since this scleral contact lens doesn't touch on the cornea, the health of the cornea is maintained. The collagen cross-linking is the first treatment to address the pathophysiology of the ectasia. It increases the corneal biomechanical strength to halt the progression of the disease, and usually done in a progressive keratoconus. And the corneal thickness should be more than 400 micron, and also it is recommended that K-max should be less than 58 diopters. Collagen cross-linking is there in the practice almost more than 10 years, and it has shown a very good results in terms of halting the progression and contact lens tolerance after the collagen cross-linking. The standard protocol is called the Dresden protocol. Dresden is a place in Germany where few of the corneal specialists sat together, and they made this protocol. The procedure goes like this. They usually, the central 8 millimeter of the corneal epithelium is scraped, and isoosmolar riboflavin 0.1% and 20% dextran is applied around. This has to be applied to 30 minutes before and every 5 minutes, so that it enters into the cornea. And then there will be iridescence of 3 microvolt per centimeter square for 30 minutes. So that there should be a total fluence of 5.4 millijoule per centimeter square. And one advantage is this can be done in pediatric cases also. The studies have shown that it is safe and effective in pediatric patients also. The one drawback is it has a increased intraoperative time, which will be boring for the patient and boring for the surgeons as well. To overcome, there are accelerated protocols that have been proposed. This is based on the Bunsen and Roscoe law of reciprocity. This means if you increase the energy and decrease the time and get the total fluence of 5.4 joules per centimeter, the effect will be same as Dresden protocol. So keeping that in mind, there are various protocols available like 7 microwatt per centimeter square for 15 minutes, 9 microwatt per centimeter square for 10 minutes, and 18 microwatt per centimeter square for 15 minutes. And results and outcome of these two, when you compare to each other, is still debatable. And how to do corneal cross-linking in thin corneas? We can use hypoosmolar riboflavin so that the corneal thickness increases a little bit. So that thin cornea is, we are worried about the UV light damage to the endothelium and intraocular structures. So when there is a cornea is already thin, the UV light enter more into the eye. To overcome, you can use the hypoosmolar riboflavin where it will increase the thickness of the cornea, and we can do the cross-linking safely. And other methods like transepithelial cross-linking and customized pachymetry guided epithelial debridement debridement so that there will be preservation of epithelium over the thinnest cornea or the cone have been proposed. And once you do C3R, that is not the end of the surgery, because usually patients ask for vision, they will come to you, come to us for the improvement of the vision. And this can be visually rehabilitated by spectacles, contact lens, or some in selective cases, toric ICL. Usually it should be done after 3 months of the collagen cross-linking surgery. Mode of treatment is PRK extra. That is indicated in early keratoconus with minimal refractive error, because we should not ablate more cornea. Usually everybody restricts up to the 50 microns of ablation in this PRK extra. It addresses both the irregular corneal shape and structural collagen weakening of the progressive keratoconus. First, there will be topograded PRK will be done, followed by immediately cross-linking. It is something like correct the refractive error and freeze it. And this has shown very safe and effective. And it also gives a good visual function and also reduces the higher order aberrations of the keratoconus patients. One more commonly practiced treatment is intracorneal ring segments. These are made up of polymethyl methacrylate arc, and it is based on the principle of arc shortening effect or hammock effect on the corneal lamella and flattening of the central. So when you place this ring segments in the mid periphery, the effect will be on the central, which will flatten the central cornea. So cone is, that is flattened. That would improve the visual acuity, and also it will increase the contact lens tolerance. And also you can delay, if at all patient needs the corneal grafting and all, that can be delayed by doing this ICRS. The commercially available ICRS nowadays are intact and Ferrara rings. And it is commonly used to treat mild to moderate keratoconus, because we need a corneal thickness of minimum of 450 microns, because these rings are placed at least in the 80% depth of the cornea. So thin corneas are not suitable for ring segments. And this procedure can also be combined with collagen cross-linking. Now, what are the management options in advanced keratoconus? Still, in selected cases, we can do a cross-linking, and other options are DALK, PKP, Bowman's layer transplantation. Deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. What you do here is, we replace the diseased cornea with the healthy donor. I mean, replace the diseased corneal stroma with healthy donor stroma. The indications are advanced keratoconus, and those patients are not suitable for collagen cross-linking, and those are intolerant to contact lenses. There are many techniques have been described, like Anwar big bubble technique and manual dissection described by Dr. Millais, and there are many variations of the manual dissection also. In big bubble, what it does is when you inject the air into the stroma, it will separate the Desmond membrane from the stroma. That is called as type 2 bubble, and sometimes the bubble would separate stroma and Duva's layer. That is called as type 1 bubble. And that would help us to dissect out the stroma. This is a small video showing the type 1 big bubble. Here the partial trephination has been done, and small lamellar dissection has been done, and with the help of 26 gauge needle, it is injected into the stroma, and it is connected to air filled syringe. And when you slowly inject the air, now it has separated the Duvall's layer from the stroma. This is called as type 1 bubble. And then you have to release that bubble and take out the stroma and replace with the healthy donor stroma. I'll stop this video because it is a little bit lengthy one. Now what are the advantages of DALK? It's a closed chamber surgery. Chances of uveal effusion or extracorporeal hemorrhages, as we see in PKP, are very negligible. And immunological rejection is very rare in DALK. And need of postoperative steroids for longer duration is not there. Thus, we avoid the complications of steroids like cataract and glaucoma. Even after doing a DALK, we have to visually rehabilitate the patients. If the patient gets the good vision with glasses, we can give glasses, or either we can go for contact lens, or we can use the Excimer laser by doing PRK or LASIK. This has to be done after all the sutures have been removed and vision is stabilized. One more option is penetrating keratoplasty. This is done in a very advanced keratoconus. And those who have an intolerance to the contact lens, and those are not suitable for DALK, and also in a post fibrops, because in post fibrops already the Desmoid membrane is ruptured, and doing a DALK is challenging and also it is difficult. One more new surgery invented by our great Dr. Millies from Netherlands. It is Bowman's membrane transplantation. It is transplanting an isolated Dominant's Bowman layer into mid-stromal pocket of a keratoconus cornea. And it is indicated in keratoconus. Now, what are the main aims of the Bowman's membrane transplantation are to halt the progression, reducing the corneal steepness, and improving the contact lens tolerance. So also to postpone the DALK and PKE procedures. The potential candidates for this surgery are advanced keratoconus with thin corneas, that is more than 65 diopter Kmax and PKE less than 350. As I said earlier, not suitable for C3R and ICRS. And it can be also used as a supplementary treatment for option for postpone the PK and DALK. And this is the technique used. How to prepare the donor lenticule of the Bowman's membrane. First, the corneal button has to be fixed to the osteophytal entry chamber, and all the epithel has to be debrided, and identify the membrane with the help of 30 gauge needle. Just to make Bowman's membrane throughout the 360 degree, and with the help of macrocystic forceps, slowly lift it and release it from the underlying stroma from all over the 360 degree. And finally, we get the scroll of this Bowman's membrane. This has to be stored in BSS. And it has to be kept in BSS. Then you have to clean with 70% alcohol so as to remove all the debris of cells, and thoroughly wash with BSS and stain with Tryphon blue. This is how the recipient This is the how you do surgery in a recipient cornea. A scleral pocket is done, and it has to be extended up to into the cornea and make a paracentesis and inject the air in the empty chamber. And this would help us to make a pocket in the cornea by identifying the air endothelial interface. And this pocket has to be whole of the cornea in 360 degree. And there will be a glide which we can insert into this pocket. And the strained Bowman membrane is just placed on the glide and entered into the pocket. And it has to be, the scroll has to be opened up and placed in the pocket. And advantage being there is no sutures required for the surgery. So suture related problems are not there. And Bowman's layer is tissue is acellular, allograft reaction may be unlikely. And note on management of hydrops. It is seen in advanced keratoconus. It is used to, as I said earlier, it is a break in the Desmoid membrane, which causes imbibition of the aqueous in the stroma. This is a clinical picture of hydrops where there is a localized stromal edema and it is totally elevated. When you do an end segment OCT, you can see this cleft of fluid in the stroma. This is also a case of hydrops. You can see a fluid collection here and the edematous cornea. The medical management is hypertonic saline to reduce the edema, anti-glaucoma medication, and lubricants. And you can also give BCL if it fits, because BCL fitting will be difficult in hydrops because of the edema and localized elevation. This hydrops usually heals by 6 to 8 weeks and by forming the opacity. For the rapid resolution of these hydrops, some surgeries have been advocated. One is full thickness corneal compression suture. We can put a full thickness corneal suture at the area of hydrops. That will help to reduce the edema and absorption of the edema so that it will heal fast. One more surgery is injection of non-expansible concentration of C3F8 into the entry chamber. So this will give a good tamponade, and this will from the back of the cornea, and this will also help the resolving the edema. This is the case of hydrops, and the C3F8 has been injected into the AC. This is the antisebumic OCT in the hydrops, and this is after injection of the C3F8. You can see the reduction in the corneal edema, and the corneal thickness, whole corneal thickness also is reducing. And how to visually rehabilitate these patients after hydrops? If the corneal opacity is not disturbing the vision, and we can try a contact lens. And if the corneal opacity is obscuring the vision, then we have to think of doing DALK or PKP. DALK will be challenging and difficult to do in such situation. Thank you. Thank you for your patience hearing.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mallikarjun. It's been a very nice and comprehensive coverage of the entire spectrum of keratoconus, its presentations, and the management.
Thank you.
We'll take some questions. There are some questions, both on the YouTube channel as well as some of the participants on the Zoom.
Okay.
Dr. Manu P. is asking, in keratoconus, which membrane break occurs, the Bowman's or the Desmoid?
in keratoconus, which membrane break occurs?
Yes, the Bowman's or the Descemet membrane.
See, the basic pathology of the keratoconus is break in the Bowman's membrane. So when that is the basic pathology of the keratoconus, and Descemet membrane also will rupture in advanced cases, but that is not the pathological feature of keratoconus. That is because of the thinning, more thinning, and this Descemet membrane gives away.
Right. Dr. Parul Dr. Parul is asking, what is the minimum age at which we can suspect keratoconus in pediatric patients? And should we evaluate any child with high astigmatism, regular or irregular astigmatism, even in absence of VKC and other symptoms like rubbing?
That's a very good question, actually. See, pediatric age group, we should have a high suspicions. So I have seen a keratoconus in a patient of 4 years old also. That was a patient with allergic conjunctivitis. And the second part is how, when to suspect, isn't it? See, whenever you see the patient with high astigmatism, or high in the sense, what is the high astigmatism? More than 2 diopters of astigmatism. If it is a regular or irregular, it is better to have a topography done. And if there is no keratoconus, then nothing to worry, and you just follow up the patients in a not very frequently. You can follow them in a longer duration. If you pick up a keratoconus in such cases, you have to follow up them every 6 months and repeat the topography. And if you have a little bit progression of the keratoconus, I usually do collagen cross-linking. And in collagen cross-linking in a pediatric age group depends on the age. If the patient is cooperative under local, I'll go ahead with the topical anesthesia. And if the patient is very angry, even you have done a collagen cross-linking under general anesthesia.
Dr. Likita Reddy is asking, what is corneal hysteresis? Corneal hysteresis.
Okay. Corneal hysteresis is a property of the cornea. We can see in a common word, you can see strength. We can see the strength of the cornea. You can just think of the strength of the cornea. How strong is the cornea? That is what the common meaning of this corneal hysteresis.
Okay. There's a question by Dr. Devakani. What is the significance of doing ORA on a KC patient and the role of hysteresis in KC?
What is the role of?
Doing ORA.
Okay. See, ORA is an additional investigation, actually. And this will not diagnose the early keratoconus. Okay, one thing. Second thing is, it is be very helpful in patients when you do a collagen cross-linking. And you do a ORA first and do a collagen cross-linking. And then follow up, if you have a ORA, follow up them subjecting to ORA, that would also give us whether the cornea has become strengthened or not. In that way, it will be very useful. And in the diagnosis of an early keratoconus, it has a very less role. And
Dr. Aparna is asking, PRK with collagen cross-linking, do we follow anything different for cross-linking here, or is the same protocol?
Usually accelerated protocols are followed, and it is not that we should not do a Dresden protocol. Usually accelerated protocols are followed, and we can do surgeons, they do an accelerated protocol, and there are people, they are doing even the Dresden protocol also. the advantages of doing accelerated protocol is you are reducing the time, because we have to do a PRK, then again C3R. So to reduce the time, accelerated protocols are all helpful.
Dr. Yash has a question. In epithelial mapping, if there is no thinning of the epithelium over the cone, does it rule out keratoconus completely?
It is it is something like that. We have to do other investigations. We cannot do only the epithelium mapping, and if there is a cornea is okay, if the thickness is okay, then we cannot just take it as a normal cornea. We have to do other investigations to rule out the keratoconus, because in a epithelial mapping, it has been shown that over the cone, especially when there is a over the cone, the epithelium thickness has been shown to be reduced, and also uneven distribution of the epithelium thickness in the rest of the cornea also.
Dr. S. Shyam has a question. He says, which contact lens should be used in what conditions?
Which
contact lenses? Which contact lens should be used in which condition of the, or which stage of the keratoconus is what I understand.
See, you can start with in early keratoconus, you can start with the soft lenses, yes, usually soft toric lenses. If it fits well, then it is okay. And I usually practice giving rose-scale lenses and also scleral contact lenses. And rose-scale lenses and scleral contact lenses can be given in a moderate and very advanced keratoconus.
Right. Dr. Devakani has a question. Corneal collagen cross-linking in pediatric group, what is the minimum age advisable to do it?
There is nothing like minimum age, actually. I have done a nothing like a minimum. When you have progressive keratoconus, I feel you should do a collagen cross-linking. I have done a patient with age of 6 years old, that I have done in a GA.
Dr. Preeti Jain has a question. In Bowman membrane transplantation, we are creating corneal tunnel till cone area and then inject tripin glue and separate tissue up to that level. But how are we sure that we are nearly in the sub-Bowman plane?
Yes. You mean how you are showing? Yeah. How sure that you are in a sub-Bowman plane, isn't it?
Yes.
See, usually it is the dissection should be at 50% depth. 50% depth. Okay. And we are not implanting the donor Bowman membrane at the anatomical level of the Bowman membrane. We are implanting this Bowman membrane at the 50% depth of the stroma into the stromal pocket. Is that okay?
I think it should be okay.
Okay.
Right. Dr. Vandana has a question. She says the pathology behind hydrops is not raised IOP. So why should we give anti-glaucoma medications in hydrops? And what is the role of anti-glaucoma drugs in such cases?
Yes. Pathology is, all of you know, is the rupture in the Desmoid membrane. Why you should give anti-glaucoma is when there is a stretch of the cornea, very highly stretch of the cornea, there can be a raise in the intraocular pressure, which would alter the trabecular meshwork. In the sense, there can be some stretch on the trabecular meshwork also, because it is so much edematous cornea, and it is so tense that there can be a raised intraocular pressure because of the trabecular meshwork stretch or alteration in the trabecular meshwork. That's why we have to give a anti-glaucoma.
And the next question is by Shanta Kumari. She's asking, how many repeat C3Rs can be done if the keratoconus is progressive?
Repeat
C3R. I think is the corneal collagen crosslinking.
Okay, how many times we can do? How many times does one see? See, failure of C3R is defined as increasing the K max of more than 1 diopters in a period of 1 year. So, and also you have to see the depth of depth of demarcation line in the cornea. You should achieve at least up to 200 microns. And if you see the patient with very anterior, demarcation line very anteriorly, as well as there is a progression, we can repeat it. You can repeat it once, and you should keep it in mind that your protocol and your quality of riboflavin and the procedure would be very accurate, so that you will achieve a good cross-linking, so that the second time it will not progress. I have done only a repetition of one time. I have not done more than one time.
Right. Dr. Preeti is asking, which protocol do you follow for C3R and why?
Myself?
Yes.
I follow Dresden protocol. This I have been doing last more than 10 years because I am very happy with the Dresden protocol, and very few, and also I do a rapid C3R wherein the irradiation will be about 10 minutes, but I'm very happy with the Dresden protocol, even in adult patients as well as in pediatric patients.
Dr. Yash is asking, in corneal thickness less than 400 microns, what would give us good results with riboflavin, HPMC or dextran?
No, you have to use the hypoosmolar riboflavin in that. So dextran is out of question. Right. The HPMC is better.
Okay. And Dr. Vaibhav has a question. He's saying, would you prefer to do DALC in post high drops patient or go ahead with PKP?
Please repeat the question.
Would you prefer to do DALC in post high drops patient?
Yeah, I go
or go ahead with PKP.
This is a very challenging situation to do DALC in such patients, because I go ahead with DALC in all post high drops patients by layer dissection method. Why I go for DALC is I don't want these patients to develop rejection by doing PKP, because we are doing in a very younger patients. My first choice is DALC, and it is very difficult to dissect where there is the Desmond membrane perforation. So there we can slowly dissect and reducing the intraocular pressure well, so that there should the intraocular pressure should be very low, and slowly dissect at the perforation area. And if there is if you see the perforation, that can we can fill up with a fill the AC with a small air bubble and continue the DALC. And if it perforates, then I convert it into PKP.
Dr. Shyam is asking, how is the grading done as per Amsler Krumage if the reading fits to different categories? For example, 59 diopters K max with 410 microns packing.
That already I have described it. These gradings are available everywhere, and you just follow it. Definitely, it will fit in the this one. Fit it into grade stage 3.
And Dr. Anita Prasad is asking, what is the incidence of scarring? Is it higher in the pediatric age group?
See, actually speaking, I have not seen much of the scarring and that is a more concern when you started C3R in pediatric age group. One was the scarring, second was the infection, because you create epithelial defect, the complaints of putting the eye drops will be putting the eye drops in the pediatric age group will be difficult. So as you started doing, and I have seen the results, the scarring, the incidence of scarring is very low, and I have not seen much scarring in the patients with pediatric age group.
Dr. Monica Budwani is asking, post collagen cross linking, when can we plan for a toric ICL?
The refraction has to be stable. Usually I wait for 1 year. And do the topography. First, I confirm that the keratoconus has been stabilized. And also, I should have a confidence that the refraction also has a stabilized. Then I'll go ahead with toric ICL.
Dr. Vaibhav is asking, is customized collagen cross-linking superior over standard cross-linking?
Superior?
Customized cross-linking better over standard cross-linking? I think I guess that's the question.
In my experience, the standard cross-linking, the distant cross-linking is better. Right. That is my personal experience.
I think you already mentioned that. Yes. Yeah. Dr. Kunal Shinde is asking, the management of form of first day keratoconus.
Yes. The form first day keratoconus, there are a lot of confusion about form first day for keratoconus, when to diagnose, which stage we should call them as a form first keratoconus. Form for keratoconus is everything is okay, but in the tomography you see the posterior elevation. That is how I follow. That is why I diagnose the form first keratoconus. When you see a form first keratoconus, you have to follow up them every 1 year. And if it is there in the pediatric age group, then more frequently I follow them. And if it is a second decade, I follow up every 1 year and do the tomography. And depending on the progression, I go ahead. And if there's a form first keratoconus, no refractive surgery. You should be careful in doing the refractive surgery.
Dr. Raghavendra Rao Jagedar is asking, when to refer a child with high astigmatism for evaluation of keratoconus?
See, what you do is usually if the astigmatism is more than 2, even if it is regular or irregular, and if the usually we do a corneal tomography in the patient based on tomography, and such patients it's better to refer them for a to rule out the keratoconus. And if the patient has a history of eye rubbing, allergic conjunctivitis or VKH, you have to refer them definitely along with your astigmatism.
Right. Dr. Preeti is asking, so we are putting, I think this is in reference to the Bowman membrane transplant. So she's asking, we are putting Bowman's membrane tissue, primarily increasing thickness over the cone. That's preventing the fibrous growth over the cone.
The main aim of the Bowman's membrane, as you said, is correct. You are just increasing the thickness. And studies have shown that Bowman's membrane is the most tougher tissue among all the, more tougher layer among all the layers of the cornea. So taking that advantage, we are putting it into the stromal layer, and so that the thickness also increases, and also it will become a little bit stronger.
Dr. Devika is asking, what is your preferred collagen cross-linking plus refractive procedure for best possible visual rehab in keratoconus patients?
I do it in a very early keratoconus patients, and my preferred is preferred in plus refractive position. It is a topo-guided PRK plus rapid C3R. That is what I do.
Dr. Shashank is asking, what are the layers between Bowman membrane is transplanted? Or in which layers, between which layers is the Bowman membrane transplanted?
It is transplanted, it is transplanted, implanted in the stroma, actually in the 50% depth of the stroma.
Right. Dr. Manu is asking, after Bowman membrane transplant, how many days will the trypan 2 stain disappear?
And that would disappear. That would disappear within 1 week, because this we have seen in even if you have seen in dal patient when you mark the stromal size in the DSEC and also in a DMEC.
Right. And there's a question. It says from the YouTube. It's how common is superior high drops?
See, it is less, so much superior hydrops is less common, but the most common area of the keratoconus is infrotemporal, but there are, in the literature, there are some reports of superior keratoconus also, but the number is very less. As far as I know, the superior keratoconus number is less and incidence also very less. So, considering that, the superior hydropsy is less common.
And Dr. Anand is asking, what is the management and investigation in a pregnant lady with keratoconus?
What is the management and investigation in pregnant lady with keratoconus? Yes, that is a good question, actually. The studies have shown that the keratoconus can start manifesting in pregnancy, and also we are not going to do that. We have to just manage with them spectacles and not contact lenses, because in a pregnant lady, the corneal thickness would have increased because of the edema. You should not give a contact lens, and we should not do a collagen cross-linking also. And this also holds good for lactating period also.
And Dr. Devakani is asking, some of the keratoconus patients complain of glare bothering vision, especially at night. Any tips to reduce this other than contact lenses?
The glare is because of the irregular cornea, and this because of irregular cornea, there will be a multiple focal points. So, in such situation, contact lens. My opinion is that a contact lens only would help in such situation, because that would reduce the glare.
I think that we've come to almost the end of the session, and the last question, I think I'll take this. Dr. Pradeep Bharti is asking, is the recording of the lecture available? Yes, Dr. Pradeep Bharti, the lecture is available online on the SAV YouTube channel. You can subscribe and always watch not only this lecture, but all the other previous ones too. With this, I think we'll close this, Dr. Malik. It's been a wonderful session. And very nice tips for the practicing doctors and also the residents and DMD students. I'm sure all will be benefiting with this. Thank you very much, Dr. Malikarjun.
Thank you, Saptagiris, for giving me an opportunity. And thank you for all the viewers also. And it was a good interactive session also.
Thank you. And for tomorrow's session, the time remains the same. It's from 12 noon to 1 p.m. And the link is also the same as for the Zoom. For tomorrow's session, it will be on retinopathy of prematurity by Dr. Divyansh, who is a retina consultant at Sankara Hospital, Bangalore. So see you all till then. See you tomorrow, same time. Take care and stay safe. Bye.